Hi. We're starting again. We have Alexander Wallet, who's going to talk to us today about Enshrew. Alex was, or is currently a postdoc at NTT in Tokyo, which means that it's extremely late where he is. So it's very kind of him to be giving this talk. Before that, he was a postdoc with Damien and Lyon and at ENS Lyon, and he got his PhD at UPMC in the Sorbonne in Paris, which, as I understand it, means that he's like lived in every city that has the best food. The top three food cities in the world are where Alex has done his education. He'll be talking to us today about Enshrew. Take it away.
Well, thank you for this introduction, and also thank you for the invitation. This talk will be based on a joint work with Shichanok, Thomas, Damien, and Keita. You can find more details about what I will talk about today on the imprint. And as the title suggests, it will be related to trapdoors over Enshrew modules. And exactly, I will try to explain to you how we obtained, let's say, a larger class of almost optimal trapdoors from these modules. So we already have some applications with these trapdoors. I will not go into much details about these today. I will just give a small sum up now. So we managed the new meaningful security efficiency trade-offs for GPV style signatures. And we also managed the acceptably efficient public key encryption scheme convertible into a chem following a design, Enshrew encrypt style. I just say acceptably efficient because it's not really better than what you can do with, standard Enshrew encryption. And there is a recent preprint by Cheon, Kim Kin, and Son that use these same trapdoors to extend the identity-based encryption scheme from Duka, Lubashevsky, and Prest. So the roadmap for this talk, of course, I will remind you of what are lattice trapdoors. I guess you already heard about Enshrew lattices tonight. I guess I will give a slightly different definition, so we will cover this at some point. Then I will enter the details on the trapdoors and the hardness of the Enshrew lattice that I will introduce. Let me say directly now that when I say I will enter how to complete and generate a trapdoor, I will not give you the same talk as Thomas. I will show you in a high-level overview how we select the parameters to actually generate the vectors on which we can actually compute the Enshrew equation just that Thomas showed you before. And to finish this talk, I will show a new way actually to complete the trapdoors that I will introduce there. And I will complete the talk with some practical applications to signatures, more precisely with some practical parameters. So for the lattice trapdoors, what I will have in mind for this talk are the parity check lattices. So I take a matrix, it has M rows and N columns, and I will look at its kernel mod Q, and I will leave this kernel inside the integers, and this will give me a lattice. So for the rest of the talk, I'd like to think as M and Q as function of the parameter N, and if you want, you can have the parameter N in mind as the security parameter for your cryptographic scheme. And this way, I can define a notion of hardness for the Enshrew lattices. The parity check lattices, being a bit too early on this. So Aita in 96, he said that the parity check lattices were hard lattice because if I gave you a uniform matrix of dimension m times n, and if you would be able to find short vector in its kernel mod Q, short integer vectors, then essentially you would be able to find a set of independent and shortest vectors in essentially any lattice of the same dimension for a polynomially small approximation factor. So this is a problem that is believed to be quite hard. So this gives a relatively strong notion of security for these lattices. And so a trapdoor associated to a parity check lattice will just be a short basis of this lattice. And by short, I mean that the largest vector in the basis should have a small Euclidean norm. And also I will often refer to the optimality of the trapdoors. And of course I have to define what I mean by optimal. So the optimality will be expressed in terms of the max norm of the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization of the trapdoor for the reason that in essentially all applications that we know, it's the Gram-Schmidt that is important more than the basis itself. And I will say that a trapdoor is optimal. I will think of it essentially asymptotically, and I will say that it's optimal when the max norm of the Gram-Schmidt is a bit around, let's say roughly around the normalized volume of the lattice. Okay, so there is a first use case. I guess it's the canonical example of what you can do with these trapdoors. I'm not going to cover it again because Thomas the first showed you already this signature scheme. I will just draw your attention to this the parameter sigma here in what I call the sampler. So for the security of this scheme, essentially, you want the signature to be short because intuitively, it should be hard to compute a short vector in the parity check lattice. So to ensure that you can achieve small signatures, you will want to have a short Gram-Schmidt, short Gram-Schmidt basis. And what we do in practice is that we sample B as a Gaussian matrix, meaning that each of its row will be a Gaussian vector with some fixed standard deviation. And this will completely determine the expected norm of a signature. And so when you know how large will be the signature, then you want to find a security parameter and a modulus that makes your SIS problem hard for this parameter range. So that's the first requirement. We want the Gram-Schmidt to be short. And the second requirement, first of all, it should be difficult for you to for the adversary to compute a trapdoor if I just give him the description of the parity check lattice. That seems relatively intuitive too. And on the contrary, it should be very easy for me that want to use the crypto system to generate a pair, which is a description of a trapdoor parity check lattice and the trapdoor itself. So there are several methods to do this. I will cover more precisely one of them today. And what I want to say here is that each method essentially determines what you can achieve in terms of the number of rows or the tallness of the matrix in terms of N and Q. So I want to cover this now, actually. There were several algorithms that were given until nowadays. So I guess the first one was due to Itai, who he extended his own work and he gave an algorithm generating a hard lattice with a trapdoor. And essentially, the trapdoor was neither optimal nor practical, but it was still a first step. Then there was the work of Gentry, Peikert, and Vaikuthanathan defined this signature scheme and IB schemes using this trapdoor lattice. And very quickly after, Alwyn and Peikert gave an algorithm that would generate a hard lattice together with a trapdoor that was this time essentially asymptotically optimal in terms of the parameters that you could have. So here, what I want to say is that in this, you see that M is the big omega of N log Q. So first, there is a dependency on log Q, and there are also several constants that are hidden there, and maybe some logarithmic factor that I forgot because I did not put a tilde, but okay. What I want to say is that asymptotically, this is practical. This is optimal, but it's not practical at all because the log Q and the constant that are hidden actually have a huge role that make the size of the data in your scheme explode if they are not dealt with properly. So the next step was actually Misiancho and Peikert giving meaningful improvements on these constants, managing to have something that was really close to become very practical, still keeping the asymptotic optimality, but still keeping, for example, the dependency in log Q, which was still a bit bothering. And I guess the next step was Duka, Lubachevsky, and Prest, who showed that you could remove the dependency on Q and keep a very small constant in front of N for the tallness of your matrix if you allowed yourself to take an N-true lattice instead of a genuinely hard lattice. And what I want to cover today is a bit of a more general way to actually take an N-true lattice and to compute a trapdoor that is still optimal while allowing for a bit more tall matrices. So I've now used this word N-true lattice several times. I want to say for a while N-true modules for some reason that hopefully will appear a bit more obvious now. Introducing some notation too. So R for me will be a polynomial quotient ring. If you want, you can instantiate phi in your head as a cyclotomic power of two because it's the use case that we like. For me, Q is always a prime. And I will think about the element of the ring here either as their vector of integer coefficients or as their multiplication matrix in the power basis. So now to define an N-true module, what I do is I take a square matrix F over the ring, not over the integers, over the ring. This matrix should be invertible as a matrix over the ring mod Q. And I take another tall matrix G, again over the ring, and I compute the product of F inverse with G, and I reduce it mod Q. So this gives me a matrix over the ring that is H. And now, essentially, what I'm looking at is the parity check lattice of the matrix H. So there is a slight abuse of notation here because I should stack an identity matrix at the bottom of H. And also, I said lattice because implicitly, I am representing all the elements of the rings inside the integers. So this means that as a lattice, this module here has full rank. It is relatively easy to see it. And it also has a volume that is, for essentially all the application that we want, it's Q to the Kn. And you can usually read this directly on the easy public basis that I gave you at the bottom of the slide here. Another important thing that I want to say here is that because we know understand these lattices pretty well, then we understand their normalized volume also pretty well. It's Q to the K divided by M plus K. And what you should have in mind for the rest of the talk is that I will explicitly wave my hand here like this. If the lattice was random enough for some notion of randomness, then all the meaningful quantities of this lattice would be hovering around this normalized volume. And this is what you should keep in mind here, because I will try to make every quantity to be very close to this normalized volume every time I do something.
So I'm confused about something very basic. Am I right that like the normal entry parameterization takes M equals K equals one, and that this is like some generalization of that?
Yes, exactly. The very standard N true is M plus K, M and K being one, and F and G being just elements in the ring.
Okay, I see. Thank you.
Okay. So to conclude, let's say this introduction, a bit of use of N true modules, and actually to rebound on what Noah just asked, all the scheme that I listed here are for M equal K equal one. You can do a bunch of things. The list is not exhaustive and I'm not gonna list everything, but you can see that you can do essentially elementary functionality in a quite efficient way if you want to look at the parameters of these guys. And you can also do more advanced stuff, so like homomorphic encryption or IBE or multilinear maps. So the N true lattice, they were already, let's say, quite liked in the cryptographic realm, I'd say. So as I said, the introduction is more or less over. So now I will jump into how to generate first half a trapdoor. And then before I complete these trapdoors, I want to discuss the hardness of the N true lattice that this will allow me to generate, in fact. Maybe if there are questions, maybe I can take one or two now, actually. If not, I just continue. Can I see the chat somewhere? No, I don't know.
I think the chat will pop up if there are questions.
Oh, right now. Okay. Then it means no questions, so I gladly continue. So the next step, if you've seen how I defined H, you can realize that the row of the concatenated matrix FG should all be in this N true module. And if I want the Gram-Schmidt of this basis, so the Gram-Schmidt seen as an integer matrix this time, if I want the Gram-Schmidt of this basis to hover around the normalized volume, well, it's essentially necessary that I ask that the rows of FNG are also around this volume as well. And in fact, this will already give quite a lot of restriction on the Gram-Schmidt norm, because there is this nice structural lemma that tells you that the max Gram-Schmidt for the integer matrix is essentially given by the Gram-Schmidt in the field of the rows of FG, or maybe the last vector that I do not know yet. So to give an intuition of why this is the case, well, when you look at the matrix in the field, you can do Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization there. It gives you vector. And then when you represent them inside the integer matrix, it actually gives you some kind of a block Gram-Schmidt decomposition. And then you can realize that every first vector of each block will be the largest one, because each block is composed of rotation of the first one that are then projected against the first. So it means that every first vector of each block of size n is the largest one, and this is why this result holds here. So I'm shaking my hands a bit, but this is not really complicated to understand, and the case m plus k equal 1 equal 2, sorry, is actually relatively enlightening already. So now if I want to have a good start for my trapdoor generation, well, I will try to select the rows of f and g as, let's say, Gaussian vectors. The standard deviation should be, well, let's take this a bit above the normalized volume. So by a bit above, I guess in practice, we take something like 1.17 or 1.2. And if I remember correctly, this was determined experimentally in a Dukal-Lubachevsky-Prest article. So I sample these Gaussian vectors. I parse them as f and g. And of course, if f is not in invertible mode, too, I just restart. So there is a very small caveat here that can have some, let's say, efficiency impact. Every time I do a Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization, I'm basically computing projections. And the projections will reduce usually the norm of the vector that is projected. So if you do not take in account this shrink norm shrinking, then what happens after the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization is that of the first vector, at least, is that B1 is the largest and the other are all smaller and smaller and smaller. So whatever the way you find to complete this basis, at some point, it needs to be compensated in a way because the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization preserves the volume. So you will find vectors that will be longer because then the Gram-Schmidt will be long enough to actually compensate for what you lose by not being careful in your sampling. But it's relatively straightforward to compensate for this. You just adapt your standard deviation for each vector that you sample. And of course, at some point, it will work. In practice, it works relatively quickly. And you get f and g. And of course, this defines you an N-true module. So there are several problems. The first one I want to tackle is the hardness of this new N-true lattice. I think that's a good moment to discuss this. And then in the next section, I will discuss how to actually finish the trapdoor basis. And also, I will try to convince you that the completion will be still nice, meaning that the max Gram-Schmidt will hover around the normalized volume. So about the hardness, we have this thing called the N-true assumption, which comes with two variants. The computational variant tells that if I give you an N-true matrix, H, it should be difficult for you to find the recover, sorry, F or G. And as far as I'm aware, there's no way to prove it rigorously, but I'd say that it's better for you if it holds or that you assume that it holds, because if it's not the case, you cannot really call this a trapdoor. So usually we say, yeah, it holds, that's fine. And a more useful variance, as far as I'm concerned, is the decisional one, which asks you to distinguish the matrix H, the public matrix, from a uniformly random matrix mod Q of the same dimension. So again, as far as I know, this is needed in every security reduction that involves these N-true lattices at some point. And so what you want to see if the public key is generated as a product of two Gaussian matrices, mod Q, you want to see if it looks like some uniform guy. So I will call epsilon S the distribution of H, where S is the standard deviation that I used for f and g. And then we obtain this new result that I formulate here for cyclotomic rings. There are two technical conditions on Q and on K and M that I will deal with on the next slide. So what I want to convey here with this result is that if you take the standard deviation to be, again, a bit above the normalized volume. So here there are a lot of factors. So this result has to be taken again in an asymptotic way. It just tells you the regime of the parameters here. So if you take the standard deviation above the normalized volume, well, actually, you can show that the distribution of the public key is statistically indistinguishable from the uniform one over the matrix, of the uniform over RQ of the same dimension. I'd like to say also that this is a generalization in some sense of a result by Stelle and Steifeld. They gave a relatively complete answer for the case m equal k equal 1, meaning that they could tackle all modulus, but it was restricted to elements in the field, not in the ring, not matrices. And to conclude this slide, I'd like to say that this result gives strong evidence that the trapdoor N-true lattices that we use, at least for signature, are relatively hard, because actually we are sampling our f and g very close to the, let's say very close, a bit above this normalized volume. So it suggests that there are indeed hard lattices.
So Alexander, yes. In SS11, I guess the way I know the result is it's stated as entry with these parameters is as hard as ring LWE. I'm wondering if a similar statement holds here, like maybe entry with these parameters is as hard as module LWE, or I'm not sure if it would be module or ring in this case.
So if I remember SS11, what it tells me is that it gives you a range of parameters where the matrix H is uniform, and then it allows you to show that the encryption scheme the cipher looks like a ring LWE sample, and then you use the LWE assumption to say that then the encryption scheme is secure. But right. I'm not sure it relates the entry assumption directly to the module learning, to the learning with error problem directly.
Yeah, you're right. I'm still curious whether there's a similarity here.
Then actually, yes, there is a semantically identical reduction saying that if H is uniform, indistinguishable from uniform, then the module and true encryption is secure as long as the module learning with error decisional version is difficult.
Very cool.
So I can comment a bit more. So it's not on the ePrint yet, but I mean, it was not a very surprising thing. We wrote it already in some draft at some point. At some point, I guess it will be public somewhere, but it's probably not surprising for people working in this security reduction things, I guess.
I see. Cool. Thank you.
But I guess, actually, I want to comment a bit more on these types of results. So I said that there were two technical conditions on Q and KM. So the first condition on Q actually relates to the number of factors that it has in the numbering. So actually it tells us that Q has very few factors. It has only two. Intuitively, that means that elements in the ring tend to be, will often be invertible mode Q because they will be coprime to Q with high probability. And the more you have factors in the numbering, the less invertible mode Q you are. The condition on M and K is, in my opinion, an artifact of our proof and essentially comes from the result below, which I think may be useful for designers. This is an intermediate result in which we computed the probability that a Gaussian matrix over the ring is invertible mode a given Q. Here, there are no restrictions on Q. And you can see that the result is essentially what you would expect. The probability does not depend on the dimension of the matrix, but it depends on, of course, the number of factors that Q has. And exactly what it tells you here is that the more factor it has, the less likely the matrix is to be invertible. But still, when Q grows, it stays relatively invertible with, let's say, you have a high chance that it's invertible still. I'd like also to comment a bit about the techniques. Maybe some people are interested in the way we obtain these results. So the proofs are inspired of Steli-Steinfeld 11, so the regularity proofs, and also the regularity proofs from Lyubashevsky Pikert Regev's toolkit. It mixes a bit the technique, and then it adds an additional layer of technicalities coming from the fact that here we are actually dealing with lattices in matrix rings, in fact. So there is a terminology, I think, that has been coined by Bonnet Freeman, which calls them multilattices. And here I'm even in the case where it's module multilattices because my matrices have entries in a ring. But it's just to say that I'm looking at additive subgroup in a matrix with entries in a number field. And it actually adds a bit of technicalities because at some point you need to understand the invertible mode Q. And it's relatively clear that it's not a lattice. And sadly, we understand the Gaussian pretty well over lattices, but not very well when the set is something that's not a lattice. For example, in this case here, it's just a multiplicative group. So to manage to come back to lattices, the technique starts with saying, okay, well, we will say that if you're not invertible mode Q, then you must belong to a lattice that contains Q in your matrix ring. And so you need to do an inclusion exclusion over all the possible lattices, so the largest one, then the one that are a bit smaller, and so on and so forth until you you arrive to Q. And these lattices, actually, you can index them by, okay, let's say if I can say this in English, you can index them by all tuples of subspace coming from a vector space over a finite field. And the cardinality of this finite field is, of course, given by the norm of the factors of Q. And this actually basically encompasses the proof of Stelle-Steinfeld 11 because it's the case where the ring, the matrix ring, has just dimension one. And so, in fact, the subspace that contains Q are just all the prime ideals that factor that divides Q. So here it adds yet another layer because the geometry allows you to have even more factors.
So there's a question for Mehdi. He asks if this choice of Q, I think he means Q congruent to 3 mod 8, is bad for implementations because it's incompatible with the number theory transform.
So it's, of course, if you want the optimalist, bestest, fastest implementation, it's not the best choice. But it's still split in two, so you could still use some very small number theoretic transform advantages. Or also you can try to come up with a very good implementation following, I guess, the ideas that maybe appears in N-true prime, where Q is even chosen inert in the N-true prime case. So they managed to have relatively efficient arithmetic mod Q. So I guess if here it factors in two factors, yes, you lose a bit in practical efficiency, but I guess for design, that's already enough, I'd say. If Great. That covers the question.
So yeah.
Okay. So I will now quit the realm of module multilattices and come back to the trapdoor generation and actually how we complete the trapdoor. And this will hopefully remind you of the previous talk at some point. And then I will finish by some practical parameters and also some open questions that I have. So from now on, the situation will be very simple. K will be 1 and M will be arbitrary. This means that my parity check matrix is now a vector over the ring. So over the integer is still a matrix, but over the ring is now just a tall vector. So I assume that I have essentially all my bases now, and I just need one last vector. And I want this last vector to actually generate the N-true lattice with the rest of the basis. So I want the determinant of the full matrix to be Q inside the number field. So to see what I can do here, I use the block determinant formula or Schur's complement, depending on the terminology you like the most. And then I recognize here that I come back essentially to something that is very close to what Thomas the second called an N-true equation. And actually I can in fact go back exactly to an N-true equation. I will just ask that F tilde here has just one entry that is non-zero. And this means that D here will be exactly equal to exactly an N-true equation where I try to solve for G prime and F prime. And so to do this, well, you use the methods that Thomas presented in the previous talk. And you can do this as efficiently as he showed you. There is another way proposed by Chion et al. In their e-print that may sometime generate a sublattice. But if I understood correctly, that's not really a problem as far as trapdoor is concerned. So now my basis is complete. And I said I want to convince you that the basis has good quality. So here are two facts that essentially comes from the preservation of the volume by the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization, both over the field or over the integers. So the first fact is a lower bound, while I would like an upper bound, but that's still okay, because what you should understand from this inequality is that the way I sampled the BIs, their Gram-Schmidt have essentially all the same size, which is about the M plus one root of Q. So here it tells you that the last one cannot be too small, and since all the other ones were essentially of the same size, well, it's not going to be too large either. So this last vector will be relatively nice. And then the last trick is that I don't even need to compute this last vector before to know its norm. I just need to know the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization over the number field of the first vector I obtained, and then I can compute the norm for free with some algebraic number theory. And now the generation algorithm is like this. So you sample the vectors with the standard deviation, as I said, just a bit above the normalized volume. When you are unlucky and the vector is too large, you resample it. When you are happy with your vectors and they give you an invertible matrix F that is invertible, you compute the norm that you would obtain for the last vector. And if you're not happy with it, you restart. At some point, it works. You obtain the last vector that has good quality. You compute it. And then you output your trapdoor and true module. So in terms of optimality, I said that this trapdoor were almost optimal. So the way I build the things, the max norm of the Gram-Schmidt is very close to the normalized volume, which is in fact very close to the smoothing parameter. So I will probably be able to sample very nice Gaussian vectors with a very understood distribution. And also the basis itself has vectors that are relatively close to the minima, which supports a bit the computational assumption, N-true assumption, because if you would try to recover the key, well, you would need to recover a set of independent shortest vectors in the parity check lattice. So in a sense, these trapdoors look like almost optimal. And again, I'd like to remind you that in practice, we select as a standard deviation something which is essentially 1.2, 1.3 times the normalized volume. So it's very, very close. Okay, now I will enter a bit more practical things. The scheme that we designed with my co-authors, we called it ModFalcon, because it reuses a lot of fundamental bricks of Falcon, like the fast Fourier sampler, the keygen, and also the philosophy in designing the compression algorithm and format switching representations. And what I want to convey in this slide is that this new scheme essentially gives you a new security efficiency for Falcon. So it can be thought as a new set of parameters. What you can see here is that we have an intermediate level of security, and we have also intermediate signatures and verification key size. You can also see that the rejection bound, so what is denoted by a norm of S in the table, is way smaller than for the original Falcon. And that comes from the fact that now my normalized volume is a cube root of the modulus. And the modulus in ModFalcon is the same as in Falcon. Of course, you'd like to compare this scheme to the other lattice-based connector schemes. And I'd say here that what we achieve is essentially what is one of the main selling points for Falcon. We achieve an equivalent security as the other known scheme. But you can see that the verification key and the signature in particular are way smaller in the case of Falcon, because I guess that's really the selling point for this scheme. Okay, so I guess that concludes the presentation. And I'd say I wanted to finish with some open questions. So I showed you some optimal trapdoors for a vector over ring parity check lattice, I'd say. Of course, natural question, can we extend this to almost optimal trapdoors for wider matrices? And I'd say that the main problem is how to complete the basis. And after thinking a bit more about it, I'd say that the main problem is more to control the completion of the basis in this case. It's less obvious that you can do it as easily as the case k equal 1. But there may be a way to do it. The second question, it's about the use of this trapdoor. So okay, we can do signature and IBE. We have also half trapdoors. And with these half trapdoors, we can do PKE and KEMS. And the question is, can we use these things to do something else and use the module design to gain some trade-off in security and efficiency again? I don't know what kind of advanced functionalities you can think of, but maybe these trapdoors can help you to design them. And the last question, it's more number theoretical. I'd be, of course, really interested into extending our uniformity results to all modulus Q and also to all dimension, removing this proof artifact that appears somewhere, or actually realizing that it's not a proof artifact would be nice too. I don't think the restriction to cyclotomic field is relevant. I think Galois field could be done. I'm not sure it's worth a try for an arbitrary number field. It's going to be a hell to manage the factorization pattern. But more generally, I'd be extremely interested to work on finding new tools and techniques to compute Gaussian mass of subsets, because this is what this is about here. It's computing Gaussian mass of things that are not lattices. So maybe there are way to look at this, let's say, in a repartition of algebraic numbers of, or harmonic analysis, or actually combination of both domains. But this is a bit far from cryptography, so you should really be motivated if you want to work on this. So I guess that concludes my talk for today. And so if you have any question, of course, I will be. It will be a pleasure to answer them.
Okay, so let's try to unmute ourselves and thank Thomas. Thank Alexander, sorry. That was pretty good. Okay, so if there are any questions, now's the time. So I have a question. So I missed somewhere it became necessary, I guess, to take M to be 2 and K to be 1. Because like, and I missed the spot where that happened, because to me, it seems like just take M to be as large as you want and things just get better and better and better. K, I'm a little less sure about, but go ahead.
So that's a good question. So K becomes one because that's the way we did not find instantly a way to complete the basis when K was larger, because you would need to find more vectors. And we did not find an immediate solution, so we just postponed it at some point, I guess. And the fact that M equals 2 is because if you take M larger, actually, you're right, the modulus becomes smaller, the standard deviation becomes smaller. And also what happens is that the basis vector becomes so small that sometimes they are sparse with 0 and 1s only. And we don't like this at all for security, usually. So you would need to increase Q, but then somewhat it's a trade-off between the tallness of your matrix and the modulus Q. And to achieve the practical parameters that we obtain, M equals 2 is the only thing that we found. So maybe there are techniques and compression things that you can use, but that's it.
I see. So you swept sufficiently much under the rug that to me it seemed like taking M to be as large as possible, like nothing goes wrong in your argument. And then, yeah, you'll get these vectors that are all zeros, which seems suspicious, but I guess there's something hidden there. So there's a very important question from an anonymous attendee, which is, why did you use row vectors?
Why did I use row vector notation?
Yeah.
That's a very good question. Usually I think every time in column vectors, but I guess when we worked on this article, I think I started in row notation and now it has stick with me, I guess. I hope I offended nobody with this choice.
Sure, you offended many people.
I'm really sorry. I was offended too the first time someone used row vector notation. I'm really sorry about that.
Are there any other questions? Let's thank Alexander again.
Thank you very much.
And I guess we'll reconvene tomorrow at 8:20 with Ilaria's talk at 8:30. So thanks, everyone. See you tomorrow.